How's this guy here doing? Did you check it this morning?
Yeah. The bottom of the
Good morning, Crossroads. So good to be with you today. How many is glad that they're in the house of God this morning? Hallelujah. Come on, this is the day that God has made. We will rejoice and be glad to give all of God, all of our praise, and all of our worship. Come on. We will stand and rejoice. Lifting one voice, you're worthy of glory, worthy of honor, worthy of praise. We will shout and proclaim the greatness of your holy name. You're worthy of glory, worthy of honor, worthy of praise. You are holy. You are holy. Jesus. Come on, we are in a house of miracles this morning. The presence of God is in this place. Hallelujah. God, we feel your anointing, God, and the power of your Holy Spirit in this place, Lord, today. Let it move from the front to the back, God, and let this be a place of miracles, God, this morning. In Jesus' name, you break the walls, mend the broken pieces, God, and mend the things, Lord, that only you can, God, and fix and heal this morning, God, in the name of Jesus. This is a house of worship. Come on. This is a place of praise. Do you believe that? Hallelujah. Where every demon trembles. Hallelujah. Where we proclaim your name. Well, this is a house of healing. And our hearts are full of faith. Thank you.
Thank you. All about you. him. Somebody say amen. I said, God, the Lord. And you know what? We welcome you this morning to Crossroads. Welcome our internet crowd to Crossroads this morning. And I don't know about you guys, but you know, when I think of 9/11, Russ and I was talking about it before we came out to the service this morning. And what a day to start revival. Amen. How many know our nation needs revival? Our nation needs revival. And we were thinking about how powerful it is. We're so blessed to have the prophet, Russ Klein, come in with us. Flew in from Virginia yesterday, and he arranged his schedule. He's working in Canada and arranged his schedule so he could be with us for some services. And Russ, I truly appreciate it. I've known Brother Russ for many years, and just a few months back, he was with us and did such a great job ministering the word, praying for people. Spot on, I'm telling you. We miss having his wife and daughter with us, but you know what? We'll take Russ. Amen. We'll take him. I'm honored to have him. And, you know, it's just something the Lord has been dealing with my heart about as we set this revival in motion, was the fivefold ministry. How many know God has a fivefold ministry? And when I look at the scripture in Ephesians 4, and it says in verse 11, so Christ himself, he gave the apostles, Max Manning, the prophet, Russ Klein, the evangelist, Jerry McCartney, the pastor, Pastor Tim, the teacher, Brother Eric, to equip his people for weeks of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach, listen to what it says, the unity in the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, and we become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. And you know what? I've had people tell me, oh, I don't believe prophecies for today, or I don't believe evangelists are for today, or I don't believe this or believe that. I don't care what you believe. Jesus set it in order. Come on, listen to me. Jesus set it in order. And it said that he organized the church so that they would have these ministries. And I'll tell you what, I'm excited about revival. Come on, amen. I'm excited. You know why? Because when we have an opportunity to go after God and God goes after us, I want to tell you what, it will change your life forever. And I was telling Brother Russ when Gavin and I picked him up at the airport yesterday, in all the revivals I've ever had in 37 years of ministry, I have never been attacked spiritually like I've been attacked for this revival. I want you to hear that. 37 years of ministry, I've never been in warfare like I've been in warfare for this revival. So you know what that tells me? Something mighty is going to happen. Something glorious is going to happen. And I'm telling you, I'm believing for miracles. I'm believing for the prophetic to flow. I'm believing for people to be saved and changed. And so that's what we're coming today. And all of our visitors, we welcome you to our service today. Thank you for being a part of our revival service. Tonight we'll be in the tent at 6:30, and you know, bring your jackets, sweaters. It's going to be a little cooler tonight. But you know what? When the Lord set this thing in order, I didn't even realize it was September 11th. I'm being honest. But God knew that we need to be revived. And so I praise the Lord for that. We're praying for passing for your family and the loss of your loved one. We're praying for them. Also praying for Stan and Sherry Devlin's son, Curtis. Some of you saw him on the prayer chain. He had an emergency appendicitis. And so they had to go to Omaha to be with him. And we're praying for him. And, you know, we're just praying for all those that are in need this morning. Need a touch from the Lord. How many got an unspoken need all over the house? I see hands. Yes. I see hands. And you know what? God is so good to us. And so, Father, as we come this morning, we just invite your Holy Spirit to come in here. I thank you for that. We want the heart of God. We want to be in the presence of the Lord. And I pray today that you'll minister to each and every one of us. And Lord, may you just continue to do the work. May you touch hearts, touch lives, Lord, just answer prayers. We thank you for the goodness and the blessing of God. And we give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor.
And the church said, amen, amen, and amen. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. We're so glad to have you in the house of the Lord. I want to brag on our kids a little bit real quick. Wednesday night, Sister Piper, I love what you put out there on the web about the kids. And, you know, I thought Joseph, he's hiding back there behind that stand. There he goes. Joseph and Angel both did a great job bringing the word Wednesday night. Amen. You guys missed it. They did a sensational job. But I was impressed with the whole worship team that did the job. All those kids that were singing. And I tell you what, we got some singers. Those kids did a tremendous job. And I was so proud of them. As their pastor, and Medi, thank you for leading those kids deeper in the Lord. What a blessing that is. And, you know, we need to pray for our young people. Somebody say amen. We need to pray for them because it's so important that the church, you know, raise them up. And I told little Cameron, he was up here playing the guitar Wednesday night, and I told little Cameron, I can't wait to hear you preach. And he just laughed. He said, me? I said, you. I can't wait to hear you preach. And but you know what? God is raising up an army. And I'm so glad to be a part of it. You'll see our offering plates up here. The middle plate goes to our evangelists. We don't hold anything out. I appreciate all of you who have been giving and helping. And Sister Linda donated her house. And Brother Russ said it was so comfortable, Sister Linda, to stay at your house. And I'm just so thankful for what you did. And we've been raising the funds because I had to fly Brother Russ in. He got a great price on his ticket and all day flying yesterday to get here. But you know what? We're excited to have him. And I don't know about you, but I'm just going to let God have his way. Amen? We're going to let God have his way so you can bring your offerings at any time and give to the Lord. Middle plate will go to our evangelists, and we'll receive an offering every night. We have 13 services. I almost had 14 service, but Michael couldn't do it. He was going to do the Sunday night at the end, but he couldn't do it. And so we ended up with 13 services. And I thought about that. I told my prayer group. It didn't hit me until Tuesday morning in my prayer group. And the Lord said, they marched around once for 6 days. And then on the seventh day, 7 times, 13 times. And the walls came down. Come on, are y'all hearing me? And the walls came down. And so we're going to have 13 services, and the walls are coming down. And I'm believing that. I've been praying about that ever since. No prayer service the next couple of weeks on Tuesdays. Give our folks a little break because we're going to be worshiping the Lord at night. And so God bless all of you. Brother Brad, man, stand and bless the offering. And as he's standing, I want to thank Brother Melvin real quick for doing all this yard work out here. If you guys hadn't seen it, you got to see this. Man, he had piles that was almost as high as my head of brush and stuff he had cut out, and he got them all burned, and then the rain came. And everything. And before you pray, also, I got to say a happy birthday to my good buddy back there doing sound for me this morning, Brother Randy. Sherry, do we have a picture? I want y'all to look at that. I snapped that yesterday, and I thought his name was Randy Lyons, but I think it's Mickey Lyons. Come on. When I snapped that picture, I laughed so hard. He's got such a great sense of humor, but I tell you what makes that picture is your eyes. Look at your eyes, man. But happy birthday to you. He turned 60 yesterday. And so everybody give Randy a hand clap of praise. Amen. Thank you for being a good sport, Randy. Thank you. All right. And Brother Brad, will you bless the offering for me? Yes, Lord. Thank you, Brother Brad. Give our worship team a hand this morning, our sound crew a hand. Sister Debbie, who works back in the coffee shop, she did a great job. And all of you, thank you for being in the house of the Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Come on, Brother Russ. You know, this guy, I have known him for many years. We went to college together, and he used to play in the praise band, and they'd play at all of our basketball games, and I'd look up in the stands. You'd be up there blowing, man. Yeah. Yes, sir. And I love this guy. Let's give our evangelist a hand and a prophet, and I guarantee you will not be disappointed. This morning, when he was here before, I had so many people tell me the word he gave to me was spot on. And you know what? That's what a prophet does. Come on, amen? And so we're going to stretch our hands to Brother Russ as we kick off this revival. And Lord, we're going to thank you right now that, God, the walls are coming down. We're going to thank you right now that the chains are going to be broken. We're going to thank you that everything that the enemy meant for naught, you're going to turn it around and bring blessing and honor and favor, Lord, and victory. And we pray today that you just let your spirit flow out of the prophet today, Lord. And we give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Come on, give the Lord a hand clap and pray.
Thank you, Tim. Appreciate it. Amen. You can be seated. Thank you, Pastor Tim. It is a delight to be with you all at the beginning of this tent revival. Believe in God for amazing things. My wife, Kim, and daughter, Shekinah, send their greetings from Virginia. We were blessed to be with you all in May, the middle of May. We were out here ministering. Kim's family's from the Independence, Missouri area. And we were here because at the stadium, the Chief Stadium, there was a big event called the Send. I don't know if any of you got to be there at it. But, I don't know, 10, 20,000 people together just crying out to the Lord, praying, worshiping, believing God to raise up his church in this season to be sent out with the gospel of Jesus Christ. So we got to be a part of that, and Pastor Tim graciously allowed us to come and be with you all again. But as he said, we are getting ready to head next week to Canada for about a month of ministry there, then on to Ireland, and next year into Mexico, India, Pakistan, different places that God is opening the door and the opportunity. But we believe this. We were singing a song earlier that said, God, I'm sorry for the things I've made worship, the things that I've made church. I've made it about me. I've made it about an experience. I've made it about my emotions. But Jesus, it's not about any of those things. It's about you. And that's what this week is, or this 13 days. It's about Jesus. Pastor Tim read from Ephesians chapter 4, and that is where Jesus gave apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. Why? Because Jesus is the ultimate apostle. Apostle means someone who's been sent with a mission from heaven. And how many of you know Jesus came to earth sent with a mission? And that is to bring heaven to earth. That is to bring heaven within us when we come through the cross. Jesus is the prophet. He is not only the one that brings revelation. The ultimate revelation we seek is not an election victory. It's not what's going to happen with the economy. The ultimate revelation is Jesus himself. And so he is the prophet. He is the evangelist. He is the good news, and he is the one that brings good news. He is the shepherd or the pastor, and he is the teacher. So these 13 days are not about apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. They're about Jesus, because all of these bring a revelation of Jesus. And so that's what we're believing over the next several days that God's going to do. So I had a wonderful time being able to get here. The flights actually made it on time. If you've been reading the news, flying is not quite what it used to be. But got in today, yesterday, and we stopped at Chili's in Liberty, had a great lunch, and had a chance to hang out with Gavin a little bit too. And then Linda, when we saw your house, it is so beautiful. Thank you for your hospitality. And there are notes all over the house, so I know exactly what's going on. And your zucchini bread was wonderful. And the apples, everything else. So look, thank you so much. We appreciate the opening your home to those of us that are coming in to minister with you all this week. Look, Pastor Tim mentioned that this is September 11th. And I don't know, you know, where you are in your memory of September 11th, where you were that day. I mentioned that we're going to be in Canada next week. We were actually in Canada on September 11, 2001. We were in Vancouver, Canada, preaching at a church there, and they had put us at a hotel near the airport. And so back in the day, I used to jog. I'm trying to jog again and get back out doing it. But on September 11, 2001, I was out jogging. It was kind of on the highway that overlooked the airport. And as I was jogging early morning on September 11th, I noticed that no planes were flying. Because typically being near the airport, I would jog and I'd see planes flying overhead. And I wonder, well, what's going on? I got back to our hotel room, and this was when Kim was pregnant with Shekinah. Shekinah will be 21 coming up this fall. And I got back to the hotel room, and Kim is sitting on the bed. The TV's on. She's crying. And she said, somebody woke me up with a phone call this morning and said, get up. America has been attacked. America's at war. Thousands are dead. And so we sit there glued to the television set, probably like many of you if you had that opportunity on that day. And I mean, we were in tears, we were in turmoil, we were angry, we were broken, we didn't know what was going on, because what much of the world lives with on a regular basis came to the shores of our nation. And I had to preach. We were in the middle of preaching a revival in Vancouver, Canada. And I had to get up and preach that night, and I felt unequal to the task. I thought, God, for all of my preaching and praying and prophesying, what I'm doing is having no real effect in the light of what happened to our nation. Have you ever sometimes looked at the magnitude of what needs to happen in our nation and our world and feel like what you have to offer is nothing compared to the magnitude of the need? And that's what I felt that night. God, how in the world can my little preaching and prophesying and praying do anything to affect the world around me? And God reminded me that the way the world is impacted and changed is one heart at a time. And understand that even though we can look at the darkness that is sweeping over our nation and the world today, that your life, your witness, the gifting of God in you is more than needed, more than sufficient to the task. Because when you impact a life for Jesus, that person will then bring the impact of the kingdom of God to others around them. And step by step, a little here, a little there, line upon line, precept upon precept, we can see a renewal, revival, awakening come to our nation again. So after 9/11, many called it a wake-up call. Now, I don't know how you all treat alarm clocks. I had my alarm clock set this morning, and it was only an hour time difference. I didn't really have jet lag, but the alarm went off, and I hit the snooze button. I don't know if you're one of those people that jump up the moment the alarm goes off in the morning, or if you set it for allowing yourself three or four times to hit the snooze button till you finally have to get up. Well, for a season, it seemed like our nation was awakening after 9/11. People started flooding to church. But unfortunately, in my estimation, the church in our nation, and therefore the nation, went back to sleep. And we thought that somehow, if we just had our mass gatherings and our prayer circles and more people went to church for a little while, that that would bring an awakening and a revival to America. But understand, a true awakening in our nation is not just more people in church and a few more meetings. It takes a change of our heart to become more like Jesus. And that did not transpire. And so in the ensuing 21 years, if you can believe it's been that long, in the ensuing 21 years, our nation has fallen deeper into slumber than we were then. Darkness is over there. Thick, gross darkness, Isaiah 60 says, is over the people. Our nation is divided. We're on the verge of, if not cultural civil war, potentially physical, but at least cultural civil war in our nation. We see the powers of darkness being thrown at us by media companies. I mean, you know, the whole Mickey thing. I mean, you know, we've loved Mickey through the years. But when you have the company behind Mickey, now with a new TV show pushing witchcraft and Satanism. I mean, what is it called? Something about a kid that is Satan's and is an Antichrist. I mean, and, you know, this is a cartoon that is being produced by Disney and others. We've come to a place where people are so confused about identity, it doesn't matter how God formed you to be. You can choose whatever you want to be. And so now we live in a place of darkness, gross darkness, thick darkness. We live in a culture where the powers that be are doing everything they can to silence the church and enslave the people of God and the people of the world. I believe there must be another wake-up call, but I pray that God in his mercy send the word of the Lord to wake us up, and it not have to be judgment. You see, judgment is not, biblically, judgment is not God's first choice for waking up a people. Romans says it is the kindness of God that leads us to repentance. God is not waiting for a chance to judge America. God is not waiting for a chance to get in your life and bring some kind of disaster, turmoil, and trauma to you to somehow set you on the right path. That's not the God that we serve. Jesus came because of love to take the judgment for us. And so what we are praying for and crying out for our nation is, God, send your mercy, send your grace, wake us up to the need of your great love. But there's got to be a voice. How will they hear unless somebody is sent? God is looking for people who will be a voice to speak the revelation of heaven in this day. And that's what prophetic anointing is about. Ephesians chapter 4 that Pastor Tim was referring to says the five ministries have been given, not so they can be on a platform and impress you with their gifting, not so you can throw money at their feet and applaud when they say something good. Our job is not to impress people with a gift God's given us as a donkey carrying the King of Glory, but what God has challenged us in 5-0 ministry to do is equip you to arise beyond where we go. Because guess what? Cameron, Missouri doesn't care that you have a prophets, apostles, and evangelists here this week. But what's going to make a difference? And yes, God's going to bring people into the tent these 13 days. I believe that. But the ultimate expression of what God wants to do this week will not be seen in the next 13 days. It will be the result that happens in the next 13 months, 13 years, and beyond. Because our job is to equip you. My job in the prophetic is to equip you to be a prophetic voice to those that God has sent you to. Because it is going to be those that speak what God is speaking that are going to awaken people to the need of Jesus. We need a prophetic anointing again like Elijah. Anybody remember a worship chorus from a few years ago called Days of Elijah? Yes. These are the days of Elijah. Declaring the word of the Lord. These are the days of your servant Moses. Righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great darkness, of trial, of famine, and sword, still we are the voice of the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Guys, that is more true now than it has been in my almost 60 years. I'm just behind you. I'm 59 and a half. The darkness that is over the face of our nation and the nations. It's grown so dark, and there's got to be an Elijah prophetic anointing that will arise and declare the word of the Lord. We don't need people's opinions. We don't just need more politics. Can I tell you, I have strong political opinions, but America will not be changed regardless of whether we have a puppet in the White House or a blowhard in the White House. It's not who is the president. It's who's the king. And the king, and he doesn't rule with an iron fist in this season, this dispensation.